Welcome to Hollywood, California, home of the stars. Welcome to Wildcard Boxing Club, home of legendary stars like Hall of Fame trainer Freddie Roach, world champions Manny Pacquiao and Miguel Cotto. Welcome to Ring City, USA, where rising stars earn their stripes in crossroad fights with careers on the line. And Saturday night main events just a win away.
And a live look inside the Wild Card Boxing Club, Ring City, USA, here on NBCSN. Over 25 years ago, Freddie Roach decided to open up this gym in Hollywood, California. So many great champions like Manny Pacquiao have come out of this gym, and it's created an opportunity for many young men and women to give themselves a shot in this sport. And Freddie will be working one of the corners tonight, Hall of Fame trainer. And what a great setting for action-packed boxing here on Ring City, USA and NBCSN. Coming up in our main event this evening, Brandon Adams, 21-3, will square off against Sonny Duverson, who took this fight on short notice, but a lot of people like his chances. And we'll get things started at 147 pounds with Ryan Ceballo taking on Larry Gomez. Gomez 10-1. With 8 knockouts on his resume. From inside the Wild Card Gym, down the stairs we take you outside where we are set up for tonight's edition of Ring City USA. So glad you can join us. Bob Popo along with 2-time world champion Sean Porter. And Sean, when you talk about the Wild Card Boxing Club, so many dreams have been made here, like your own. You'll tell that story a little bit later on, but this is an opportunity tonight for young men to put their name right in front of the general public's psyche.
You're right, and we had a great first event out here, a lot of action and a great finish by Oshaki Foster, and of course, some glass, just in case you mess up my name again.
Yeah, I ain't messing you up tonight, nor do I want to get hit. You're a 2-time world champion. Let's take a look and talk a little bit about Brandon Adams, who's fighting in tonight's main event. Change of opponent, short notice. As a boxer, you got to be prepared for anything, but how does that sort of change your mindset?
Well, you know what? We get paid to make adjustments. That's what we do. That's a part of our game. So I'm sure Brandon was able to make the necessary adjustments, come in, weigh in, looks great. He'll be ready tonight.
Yeah, he's got a lot of confidence, and that's coming up in our main event against Sonny Duverson. Let's take you back inside the Wild Card Boxing Club and welcome in Kern Bhatia. Kern?
Thanks, guys. I'm here with our main event headliner, Brandon Adams. So, Brandon, you are getting ready to fight Serhii Bohachuk. It was a late opponent switch to Sonny Duverson. How have you prepared for that? How have you changed your mindset? And how are you physically preparing for that change?
Well, we can prepare as much as we want. The fight, it changed very last minute. All we could do is be mentally and physically prepared before we got into the ring, and them switching the opponent for me, because I felt I was ready to fight the Bohachuk, that I was looking forward to fighting him and pushing myself. I felt I was prepared and ready to fight this fight as well.
And Sonny Duverson is going to have the height advantage, 3 to 4 inches. He has an 80-inch reach. So how are you going to neutralize that size differential?
I thought I was 8 feet tall myself. No, but honestly, you know, my whole career I fought against guys who were taller than me. So, you know, I'm used to it. I'll have to get, you know, used to him, adjust to Sonny when, you know, we'll be getting there and fight. But for the most part, you know, I've always fought against guys who are taller than me. So I'm looking forward to the challenge.
Sonny Duverson is now known as Short Notice Sonny. And on more on that, let's go to BC.
Thanks so much, Curran. Here at Ring City, you don't have to look any further than the ring ropes to know what we're all about. Hashtag anyone, anytime, anywhere. It's certainly a mission statement best exemplified by Sonny Duverson. Tonight, his third fight in just 55 days, the third different promotional quarantine bubble he has entered. The call went out last week, of course, when Serhii Bohachuk pulled out. Upwards of 20 junior middleweights were reached out to. The only one to say yes, turns out it was Sonny's manager and trainer, Brian Carter, who said in a 60-second phone call, Sonny's old school, he'll take the fight. A follow-up was sent out to Sonny. He answered in the sauna. 30 seconds later, he said, can you do the fight at 156 pounds? I am in. Talk about daring to be great. I asked Sonny about that old school nature, and he said this, most of my adult life, I was in and out of prison, letting opportunities slip by me. Tonight, it's all about opportunity, and I'm going to seize it. Hey, high risk taking a fight against a fighter of Brandon Allen's caliber last minute, but high reward available to him with a win just the same.
Yeah, and Brian, despite the fact that Sonny took this fight on short notice, a lot of the wagering that's come in late has actually gone on Sonny. So he is a live wire, and certainly a lot of people are backing him, thinking that on this short notice, he's got an opportunity to do something great tonight against Brandon Adams. Obviously, safety is a main concern here with Ring City USA. Let's take a look at some of the safety protocols that have been followed. There's been COVID testing for all the participants in the card, the promotion, the broadcasters, everybody. No fans in attendance, obviously. Social distancing important, and obviously, masks always at a premium, except for fighters in the ring. Well, we're getting set for our first bout of the evening at 147 pounds. And let's take a look at the tail of the tape for Brian Sabayo and Larry Gomez. Take a look at the numbers, and you see that, Gomez rehydrated to 155 pounds. Sabayo rehydrating as well. You see the reach advantage in favor of Sabayo, who's got a degree in finance, and he would like to calculate himself and add up a sweet victory tonight. Time for the introductions. Here's our ring announcer, Lupe Contreras.
Ladies and gentlemen, we welcome you to the house that Freddie built. The Wild Card Boxing Club, Hollywood, California. This is Ring City USA, presented in association with Bash Boxing and 360 Promotions. This is our co-featured bout of the evening on the line. The vacant WBO Intercontinental Welterweight Championship, set for a distance of 10 rounds and being scored by at ringside. The judges, Max DeLuca, Ron Scott Stevens, and Ivan Guillermo. At the sound of the bell, the ref in charge of the action, Raul Kais Jr. Presenting first, the fighter standing in the blue corner. He steps in wearing maroon trunks with gold and white trim. When he stepped on the scale, he registered an official weight of 145 and 3/4 pounds. He enters the ring for the 12th time as a pro with an outstanding record of 10 victories. One lone defeat, eight of those victories coming by way of knockout. Ripping Salt Lake City, Utah. Larry Hitting Hard Gomez. Across the ring in the red corner, wearing white with dark blue trim, he weighed in just shy of the welterweight limit at 146 and 3/4 pounds. And he enters the ring with an undefeated professional record consisting of 11 victories, six of those victories coming by way of KO. Fighting out of Brooklyn, New York, Brian Sabayo.
Fighter Chief, second only, please. Fighter Chief, second. Mouthpiece. All right, gentlemen, you received the instructions in the dressing room. Know what I expect? A good, clean fight. Legal punches, here for you. These are a bit high, here for you. Touch gloves, good luck to both of you.
So we're outside the Wild Card Boxing Club, and obviously the weather was fantastic earlier today in Hollywood, California. 67 degrees, but it cools as the evening wears on. You got to make sure that you're properly warmed up. Larry Gomez hitting hard, 27 years of age. Limited amateur experience in his resume, where Brian Sabayo, all he could think about was making it to the Olympics and winning an Olympic gold medal. That didn't pan out. Decided to focus on the pro game, and here we go, round number one.
It's cold out here, but these guys aren't going to have a hard time getting warm. I think we're going to get a lot of action in this fight. I think this is one of the most exciting fights of the night.
One thing you'll notice right away about Brian Ceballos, this may be his 12th pro fight, but he is poised, he is confident, he is patient. There's a lot of technical things to like about his approach inside the ring.
I agree 100%, BC. I studied him, and that's what I was impressed with, his patience and his composure in the ring. I know Bob just said that he lacks an amateur experience, but he started at 8 and basically continued on. And even beyond that, he comes from a family of fighters. Dad was a pro, uncle was a pro, so he'll be all right tonight.
Yeah, his uncle, Gary Gomez, a cruiserweight, had 30 bouts as a pro. As for Ceballos, in the white trunks, 206 amateur wins. He's one of only three to win the New York Golden Gloves Championship 5 times, joining Mark Breland and Samuel Pagan.
That's awesome. I mean, guys like Daniel Jacobs, you're telling me he didn't win it 5 times? For Ceballos to do something like that, it's pretty impressive.
Hector Camacho, there's many names we could go through.
Ceballos trying to use the jab, just trying to set something up. And he said that in the fighter meeting. I'm going to go in there and then adjust to my opponent.
Well, that's the thing. We really pressed him to say, how do you describe your style? He wouldn't give. He's basically in there as a chameleon to transform into whatever the opponent is offering. And right now, the opponent, Gomez, known for being an aggressive type, has been a little bit quiet off the start, though.
But even right there, Ceballos, he landed 2 lefts in a row, and it was because he's been jabbing to the body. I'm talking about setting things up. And then right there, just ripping off his hands. A guy gets used to a jab, 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 and then now you're able to use some other offensive weapons.
Gomez with 5 first-round knockouts. Ceballos' only first-round knockout came in his pro debut back in 2018.
I tell you guys, I love this fight. Ceballos is a good boxer. We're seeing it right now. And Gomez is not going to take any steps back, and he's going to bring the fight, and he's going to land some punches of his own like he did right there.
Slip, 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 slip and punch. Come on. There you go.
Beautiful combination from Ceballos. It's so crisp.
10 seconds. Stop the bell, gentlemen.
So
10 seconds.
Real.
Yeah, yeah. I, no disrespect, but amateurs do things like that. They're able to rip off 4 and 5 punch combinations like he did.
End of round number 1.
You bleed. I don't want you going in front of him. Why can't you? Okay, that's where we're going. Okay, I want you going behind him, not in front. Okay, you're moving too much.
Okay.
You're just swinging 1 point. Just make a miss. See right there, and you'll be jumping on too much. Okay?
Okay.
Good. Too much running around. All right? Stay in the pocket, make a miss.
Come on, you're all right. Don't even.
Don't worry about the first round. Let's go. Let's start moving. Start
working. Take a look at some of the good action from Brian Ceballos in round number 1.
That was just a good hook, lead hook that was set up by jabs to the body. He caught Gomez sleeping, fainted to the body, and when he reached for it, he was able to land the left hook.
I saw Larry Gomez come out to start round number 2. When you think of boxers, you don't think a lot of guys that come from Utah, but the great Gene Fulmer was from West Jordan, Utah, 1957. Beat Sugar Ray Robinson for the middleweight championship. Stop. Little Red Lopez, former featherweight champion, also from Utah.
Yeah, I was surprised to hear this kid from Utah. And tough. And can box. Gomez hasn't gotten started yet.
Watch your elbow. Let him go, Brian. Let him go. Hands are free. Punch out of there.
Double S Steve Smoger gives round number 1 to Ceballos.
All right, Steve, we're on the same page.
Hall of Fame referee.
Don't be getting under Steve Smoger's skin. He put hands on Carl Marat that time in the Bernard Hopkins fight after he was following a little bit too much. I see you, Double S.
Yeah.
Ceballos was actually born in Puerto Rico. His parents went from the Dominican Republic to Puerto Rico, moved to New York, then went back to the Dominican Republic and was raised by his grandmother for a couple of years where his parents got settled. And he told us, you know, not only does he fight for his own success, but all of the sacrifices that his parents made to provide a better life for him, inspire him every time he steps into the ring. For more on Sabayo, let's send it over to Kern.
Brian Sabayo seemingly has it all. Undefeated as a professional, won the New York Golden Gloves 5 times, like we said, owns a gym in Manhattan, has a finance degree. The one thing he doesn't have, guys, is a boxing nickname. And to the rescue was Showtime Sean Porter at our fighter meeting. It was like an old-time movie. He wrote some names down, slid it across the table. No one knows what's on there. I went up to Sabayo at the weigh-in. I said, hey, so did you pick one? He said, I'm still reviewing the list. So I don't know if that means he's not decisive, or Sean, I don't know if those nicknames were any good. I don't know. What do you guys think?
Listen, I'm known in my family and friends for not coming up with good nicknames. So I'm not surprised at all that he hasn't picked anything yet.
Sean, you got to reveal the one you thought was perfect for Sabayo.
Well, listen, I'll reveal what success Sabayo's having tonight. How about that? He's a good boxer. He's got good foot movement. He's in and he's out, and that's the big problem for Gomez right now.
Yeah, you saw him double up that jab beautifully.
Yeah, and it's the timing for Gomez that he's having a problem with right now.
We talked about Sabayo and his extensive amateur background. A little bitter toward USA Boxing with the way things kind of shook out for him at the end. He said he always dreamed of being an Olympian. Didn't even really, and doesn't really like to watch boxing. Says, I enjoy the challenge of being an elite athlete.
Stop at the bell.
And I was honored to hear he watched my fight with Spence Jr. last year.
Listen for that bell.
He says he doesn't watch much, but he watched that one.
Time! Good job.
See it. Ceballos got, he's working good, and he's setting up punches. Big hook right there, and then he's in and he's out. That's the problem for Gomez right now.
They let him miss. When he miss counter, don't just time off. Okay? Good. See inside, they make him miss counter. Right, you see what it? Come on. Touch, make him swing. Keep touching.
Let's go.
Okay? Let's do a little touching. Come on. More punches. They aren't school. Come on. All right?
Listen, Mr. Campbell, I told you that Gomez has a good jab. He's going to try to use his jab to work his way in, as he should. He's fighting a taller, rangier guy, and he's got to start with the jab.
Round number 3 underway between Brian Sabayo and Larry Gomez.
You can see that Gomez is falling for the feints that Sabayo is throwing at him. He's going to fall for every one of them.
You don't have to watch a lot of tape on Gomez to realize how much he's in love with that counter right hand. And certainly, he's going to have to show a good chin to take some stiff shots from Sabayo to get close enough. But that's the shot he's looking to line up.
Every now and then, you got to take some to give some. And just, it's a part of the game. Unless you have some excellent defense and some excellent timing.
There you go.
Hey, back. Come on. Touch again. Don't wait for him to swing. Come on.
Steve Smoger has it 2-0 in favor of Sabayo.
Sabayo's he's controlling everything. He's controlling the range. And he's finishing the exchanges
come on,
too.
Just get it going. There you go.
Big hook there.
Good.
Watch
keep
your
coming.
Hands, guys. Watch your hands.
Yeah, that's it. See, that's it. Move your
hands
head and
are
punch.
Free.
Come on. Move your head and punch, Larry. Let's go. Work. When you're close, work.
The one thing I know about Larry Gomez is he comes from a family of fighting, and that means that's what he's going to do. He's going to fight. At the end of the day, he's going to fight. And you're seeing it right now. Of course, we just said it. He's taking a couple, but he's starting to land.
Get off his head.
Well, he may,
hands are free. There you go.
He may be raw in comparison to the technique Sabayo is showing, but Gomez very comfortable in that pocket, whether he's getting hit or he's slipping shots. And, you know, you may not know a lot of champions from Utah or contending fighters, but there is that family background. His father had 2 pro fights before eventually dying early, but it's his uncle, Gary Gomez, in his corner, former cruiserweight and heavyweight fighter who fought the likes of Tomas Adamek. So this is a boxing family, and he said if you can describe the Gomez style, it's straight ahead. He's coming there to let those hands go.
Straight ahead, but the thing he's doing well is going to the head and the body of Sabayo. And he's starting to rip more. You know, guys that are fast and can box like Sabayo's got great boxing ability. combinations and power. You break them down.
Good combination of the body by Ceballo.
And to this point, three rounds in, I think that that was really the big knock that I had on Larry Gomez, was he doesn't move his head and he doesn't block a lot of the shots. He wears quite a few, if not on his face, he's wearing them on his gloves. But he's strong like that right there, coming with a counter over here, right?
Come on, 10 seconds. Stop at the bell.
Every time Gomez lands a shot, Ceballo uses movement and is able to connect. Good combination there, and a counter by Ceballo. Hall of Fame trainer Freddie Roach with the best seat in the house from inside the Wild Card Boxing Club. He's got Gore Yuritsian, who we'll see a little bit later on tonight. Young prospect as we begin round number four, Brian Ceballo and Larry Gomez.
You're throwing one at a time. Give me four, five, and six. Come on.
No punch.
This is 2020, so everyone is going to enter the ring with some kind of layoff. 425 days for Ceballo is nothing to blink at, but I think you're seeing he's been active in the gym. This has not been a problem or an adjustment to make. He's just got to worry about Gomez really loading up with something wild here. Gomez working hard to get some respect by drawing that line in front of Ceballo and standing right on top of it.
Both guys, they're doing a very good job tonight. I got a feeling Smoker's against me right now. I get the last round of Gomez. I just think that he's starting to get to Ceballo a little bit more than he was the first two rounds.
Yeah, I'm sticking with Double S in that last round. I think Gomez had a better round, but I don't know if it was a good enough round to win the round.
Right. Maybe that's what I see. I'm rewarding the effort and success. You both may not have been as much as I thought.
Well, Sean Porter does like to pressure fight. I don't know if you remember the Andre Berto fight. I mean, you threw fists at him, threw kneecaps, elbows. I mean, whatever was legal, you
not
pulled
true.
It off.
Not true at all. Not true at all. I do what it takes to win, and that's what Larry Gomez is doing.
We talked about Ceballo's amateur background. We were talking with Larry Gomez about coming from a boxing family. His uncle's in his corner. His dad got him into the sport. His father passed away when he was 9 years old, a battle of alcoholism. He said, hey, look, it runs in the family. I don't touch it. I want to break that chain in my family. And Gomez certainly setting an example for his four kids.
Absolutely, that's important.
That one was right on the belt line, maybe a little low for Ceballo.
I tell you what, Ceballo, the one thing I'm looking for when you watch a young fighter, can you make adjustments? Can you be consistent? Can you stay poised? And I'm seeing that from Ceballo. He comes out and he's just using the jab. Right now, the jab is working. Why do any more? Why try to force things that aren't there? And right now, he's having a lot of success with the jab, and then he's working off of it.
Sean, one thing I noticed from Ceballo in previous fights is he'll change speeds a lot, especially at close range. What does that do with mixing in a changeup, if you will, on a baseball reference to your opponent?
I've never played baseball, but this is what I know about boxing. When a guy goes from throwing one or two punches to all of a sudden four or five, you're not ready for four and five. And I think that's where he's surprising.
Stop at the bell.
Do it again.
Good round for Ceballo as we come to the end of the fourth.
Big right hand. Big right hand.
I can see it right here. Right, that's it. Stay right there.
He's getting more and more into heart.
Yeah. I know, but so you don't need to run though. Stay right there, let him miss. And keep touching and make him go fast. You understand? And then later we can start putting it a little harder. But right now you're just trying to keep touching.
That's why you gotta get closer. Move your head. Move your head and get close. Move your head and get close to him. Move your head and get close, and then punch in combination. Don't worry about the last round. Let's just get started.
All
right. Let's just get started. You got a punch in combination. One, two, four.
It's all Sabaya right now. The jab, the hooks. He's turning everything off. He's even able to get to the body right now, which I think is very good. Oh, there's a body shot right there. And then, so professional. Smother your guy so he can't come back on you. Very professional. 11-0, but he's very professional. I like what I heard out of Gomez's corner, too. They're saying, hey, don't worry about the last round. Just keep working. Moments like this, when you're not having the kind of success you want, just stay patient. Stay poised.
So, Sean, what does Gomez need to do to sort of try to get a little momentum in this fight right now? Because right now, Sabayo is the guy controlling the pace of everything.
Even with the coaches yelling, he's saying, give me three and four. You can't continue to give me one. You got to step to Sabayo, smart, intelligently. Make him miss and then make him pay, but don't make him pay with just the one overhand right. Like there, change your level, change the angles, and then explode. That's what he's able to do.
More on the corner of Gomez. We check in with Curran.
Gomez, trainer and uncle of Larry Gomez. He doesn't want more movement, doesn't want more defense. He's asking for more pressure. He's saying let the hands go. They were happy with what they saw at the end of the last round, but they want more. Back to you guys.
Let him go, Brian.
Want more. Get to the body. I think that's the most important point or part for Gomez right now is to get to the body and try to break down this fast kid who's just coming out of a very good Olympic run.
There goes the mouthpiece.
And what does he do? Fight harder. You gotta love it. You gotta admire it. And a fighter, that's what we do. We fight.
Stay in that corner. Talk. Okay, does Rinsa for me?
I'll tell you what, Sean, you may have taken it as a compliment for Brian Sabayo, a guy who openly says he doesn't watch boxing, that he's watched your fight with Spence. If he keeps on this run, it might be a scouting mission. You know, this may not be a tribute watching that fight.
When I saw that he was a welterweight, I was like, I'm not fighting him. But, you know, to be in a meeting and hear him say, I don't watch very much boxing, but I watched you. It's a compliment to me, and it makes me want to watch him. He's doing good.
Gomez loses the mouthpiece again.
He's smart. I knew he was smart. He's got a degree. What's his degree in?
Finance, yeah.
I knew he was smart, and I wanted to see just how smart he was because in the fighter meeting, he says, I'm going to go out there and adjust to my opponent. I don't really have one style or one game plan. And to see him make these kind of adjustments is very impressive for a young fighter.
You got to keep it in a close by accident. Yeah, here we go. There you go.
You heard Gomez say it was by accident with the mouthpiece coming out. Maybe it's an effect of some of those hooks to the body.
Yes, twice. Let him
go, Brian. Put your left arm out, Larry. There you go. Hands are free. Hands are free. Punch it.
See, this is real boxing. Sabayo goes from using the jab, being on the outside, to now he's going to use some fast combinations, boxing them and turning them and just touching them.
What I like about Sabayo here is he's got the better skills, yet he's not afraid to get a little bit rugged. When Gomez crosses that line, as you saw just in that sequence, he's able to push him back a little, body him up a little.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. He's able to also smother Gomez and not allow him to get off when he gets to the point where he wants to be, right there on the inside.
Larry, I know it's an accident, but you got to keep them up close, okay?
Working, Larry.
For a second, I had lost you.
Okay.
I'm good now.
You good? Okay. Yeah, we got about it. Okay.
Give me a real quick round.
Yeah, look over there. Get. Look, look.
Start at the bottom, then end up top. You have to, yeah?
Okay.
So, Kobe, you good about it? That's not the good story. That's not the matter. All right, let it come. Let it come.
Well, seconds up, mouthpiece in. Mouthpiece. Take a step back for me, please. Box.
Mouthpiece coming out right there by Gomez. It is an accident. I don't think it's something that he's purposely trying to do, but sometimes you're working hard and you're trying to get to somebody and you're pushing out that air, and mouthpiece goes with you.
Round number six underway. No knockdown so far in the fight. Brian Sabayo has controlled the action from the beginning.
I think I had my first 10-round fight when I was 12 and up. And or going on my 12th fight. A lot like Sabayo right here. And basically, at this point, you're in control. Just stay composed and just continue to work. Right now, it's about consistency. This is how you grow as a fighter.
I saw Steve Smoker give round number five to Gomez.
Should I comment on that, man? He's confusing me now. I don't know what he's doing. I'm going to let him do it,
well,
man.
Well, let's give Gomez some credit. He's plenty game. He is making Sabayo work in close range.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think maybe just Smoker and I, he's seeing something one minute that I'm not. And, you know, we've gone the opposite direction, I think, twice now. And no big deal. Good big left hook right there.
Stop. No punch. Get off his head.
John, let me ask you this. You mentioned about your career arc. If you're a guy like Brian Sabayo, right, and you got this great opportunity, you're controlling the fight, do you feel a little added pressure as we get to this part of the fight now, trying to finish strong and maybe make a bigger statement and become reckless?
You know, it's crazy because when I had my 12th fight and I was my first 10-rounder, it's a blur. But it was a blur in the moment, but I was able to learn from it. I think right now he's smart. He's a lot smarter than I was at this point in my game. He's going to stay smart, and he's going to continue to box accordingly, opposed to taking risks and hurting himself.
With that said, though, Sabayo's fighting anything but safe right now. I mean, he's in close range. He's getting off first. He's landing the bigger shots.
I agree. He just got hit with a big overhand right. And I mean, if anything, that's a testament to his chin and his head. You know, he's able to take it and stand in there and continue to fight.
Good right and left to the body from Gomez.
I got
to
tell you guys, like, this is what I knew we were going to get
go,
out of this fight. I knew we'd get
go,
10 hard rounds and
go.
We
Hands
get a
free.
Good boxing match. You got one. Both guys are good boxers, good skills. But one guy just a little bit more than the other in terms of skill, and the other guy fighting with heart, and that's what makes a great fight.
10 seconds, stop at the bell.
One thing Gomez told us was that he thought that Sabayo would
Larry.
Do a lot of running. Sabayo certainly has not done that as we come to the end
bell.
Of round six.
Good. We'll hit him in the back,
Sunday night, the Denver Broncos head to Kansas City to take on Patrick Mahomes and the defending Super Bowl champion Chiefs in an AFC West showdown. The Chiefs are coming off a 6-game win streak, 10 straight against the Broncos. Sunday night, 7 Eastern, only on NBC. You see, yesterday with Wednesday afternoon football, the Pittsburgh Steelers remained undefeated with their win over Baltimore. And Sean, look at that.
Oh,
we're in December,
man.
And your Browns are
8-3. Hey, take it easy, man. 8-3 is good to see my guys finally get talked about at this point in the season.
Move your head.
In December.
Move your head.
Yeah.
That's it. Move your head. And they work.
And the Broncos, with Vic Fangio, their head coach, have been talk about game when we talk about fighters.
Yeah.
The Broncos have been game this year.
Yeah, that was a bit of a mess that they've been in this past weekend. I'm hoping they can turn things around.
Stay right here. Come on.
Slow. When you start with speed, you're going slow.
Good. Now, bunker, bunker. Come on. Come on. Bunker. Come on. Go. Go. Come on. Punch.
Look, you can't pass go in boxing, meaning you can't become a star without earning it in the ring. It is hard, though, to watch Brian Ceballo through 11 and a half pro fights and not feel the potential for stardom jumping off of it. Great body. Can fight both styles. Bilingual. Puerto Rican descent, grew up in the boxing hotbed of Brooklyn, New York, pays homage to the Puerto Rican boxing heroes before him. If he keeps winning, he's the kind of kid, great on the microphone, he's going to get a fan base behind him, pushing him just as far.
Yeah, I agree. I love his kid straight up and down, everything about him, especially the fact that he's a Puerto Rican kid who just loves boxing. I mean, that's what that foundation of fighting is for the Puerto Rican.
Let him go. No, stop.
Listen, those guys just love the sport. And to see him get in the ring and do it simply because he loves it is awesome.
Be ready when you're done working. Come on. To move your head. Let's go.
And I do think that he can become a star relatively soon in the sport if he continues on this road here.
The right hook. Come on.
Use that jab. Use the jab. Come on. Use the jab. Work. You're there.
I think the best thing that Ceballos got going for him is his intelligence, his ability to adjust, his ability to recognize his opponent, strengths and weaknesses, what he needs to do, and his timing is very good as well.
I mean, 225 amateur fights, more or less, will prepare you for that. But the adjustment he has made so far as a professional, he does look impressive making that transition.
He has taken some pretty big overhand rights and hooks. The one thing I would want him to see now at this point is protect yourself, roll off of some of those shots, like that right there. It's a small lean to get out of the range, and then and just continue to work. You see the adjustment there, the big overhand rights and hooks, and now you see Ceballo. He just took his head and went all the way down, almost to Gomez's hips. And because he knew he'd be safe. Come on. It's intelligence.
Gomez's corner, I tell him,
just keep working. It's starting to click for him.
Final seconds of round 7, scheduled for 10.
Time!
Well, the sports world was saddened to hear the loss of one of its all-time greatest athletes, Rayford Johnson, passed away yesterday at his home in California. 2-time Olympic medalist, memorably winning the decathlon gold at the Rome Games in 1960. He was a multi-sport star at UCLA, where he played basketball for John Wooden. And after he ended his athletic career, he founded Special Olympics Southern California and served on the President's Council on Physical Fitness. Johnson is survived by his wife, Betsy, his 2 children, and 4 grandchildren. Rayford Johnson was 86. Round 8 of the scheduled 10-rounder underway. 147 pounds, Brian Ceballo out of New York City in the white trunks against Larry Gomez in the red. No knockdowns in the fight. For the most part, Ceballo has controlled the action. The sharper, quicker punches in this fight, controlling the ring.
A lot of close rounds tonight, too. We got to give Gomez credit for, first of all, his heart. And also the adjustments that he's making, hooks and overhand rights, he's able to start landing those now.
Yeah, Gomez is tricky, and he does hit hard. You can see when he lands these hooks in close. It just hasn't been a consistent amount. Really hasn't been able to build off the jab too much.
2 slips right there. He slipped. Ceballo made him miss a jab, and then he leaned the other way and made him miss a right hand. I mean, the anticipation that this kid has, the instincts that this kid has, they're impressive.
So he's trying to smother your power.
Pull your arm out, Larry. There you go. Hands are free, gentlemen.
And Larry's corner's smart as well. You know, hey, he's smothering your power. Push him off you and keep working.
Again, touch again. Go on, the right time.
Good information from both corners.
Gomez described getting a chance to fight here in Freddie Roach's backyard of wildcard boxing as a dream for him, his extended family. He even said, Sean, meeting you was a dream. He's going to go back to his full-time job after this fight. He's a team lead in a warehouse in Utah that makes workout protein. But to make this fight a little bit more than a dream, Sean, to be in this fight, on, if this goes the distance on the scorecards, is now the time to let danger go and let your hands go?
Now's the time. I think that's what his corner wants, but now's the time. Start pressing this kid and basically throwing everything you have. You got 3 rounds left, well, almost closer to 2 rounds left. You got to let it all hang out. Don't wait. Don't wait. That's what the corner's saying.
Sean, obviously, as a two-time world champion, you're always on the positive side of things. But as do fighters feel like, hey, I'm probably behind on the cards? Do they feel that, or the confidence always thinking I'm winning in a certain aspect?
We definitely feel that. That's something we feel. We know when we're getting hit too much, and we know when we're losing the fight. And then it becomes a mind game. And it's a struggle sometimes to keep yourself in a place where you continue to stay positive and just continue to work on whatever your corner's telling you to do. That's what makes boxing so interesting. I mean, you have so many different components. You got the fatigue. You got another guy coming at you. Nonstop punches, and you're trying to protect yourself, all that. There's a lot to fight through, and we have to respect both men every time they get in the ring.
And round number 8, inside the Wild Card Boxing Club, Freddie Roach will have Gore Yuritsian. Gore Yuritsian, 13-0 from Armenia. Told us the story. He came to Wildcard Boxing Club when he was 17, took a picture with Freddie Roach, and then a couple of years later came back. Freddie watched him work out and said, you got a trainer? He said, no. Freddie said, love to work with you.
I love that story.
It was that easy, right?
I love that story. With Freddie, he's a very simple guy, and sometimes it can be that easy. When he sees something that he likes, he wants to help. And I think that that's why he's so admired in the sport in terms of being a coach.
Yuritsian will take on Mohanry Montez. Round number 9 underway between Brian Sabayo and Larry Gomez. Sabayo has controlled the action in this fight. Okay, so Sean, we talked a little bit about Gomez and the fact that most likely he's got to feel like he's behind. What does he need to do now to throw a little caution to the wind and create some opportunities to change this fight?
And it's hard, too, because the beginning of the round, Sabayo came out and his body language was different. He was showing, like right now, he's showing he wants to come at Gomez. And so Gomez, again, like I was saying at the end of the round, not only are you fighting through fatigue and you're fighting through the feeling that you might be losing, now you're fighting through the feeling that you got a guy coming at you, you know? So now he's really trying to figure out what offensive attacks he wants to use.
Well, let's give Gomez credit here. The best work he has done in this fight has been in the final 30 seconds of each round. He's had some nice left hooks to the body, some good counter right hands. I don't know if that's Sabayo slowing down just enough, knowing that bell is coming, but Gomez certainly gonna have to start earlier to make an impact here in the final round.
He's got to start earlier, and the thing that he needs now is momentum. He needs to catch Sabayo with something that makes him feel like he's going to get him. And that'll be the thing that really changes the complexion of the fight for Gomez.
You know, although that three-punch combination was blocked by Gomez, nothing coming back from Gomez.
The big thing with Gomez is his lack of defense. Now we're seeing him move a little bit and slip. But if you do that earlier in the fight, you might have more success because you haven't had a guy hit you and break you down. And what I want to see out of Sabayo at this point is stay strong, stay consistent, continue to use a fast jab, continue to smother this kid when he gets up on you, and continue to throw the right punches at the right time like he's doing.
Up and down, rise up and down. Hands tight, move your head. There you go. Oh.
Sabio picking him apart with the jab there and then getting out of harm's way.
There goes the mouthpiece one more time.
I like Coach try to grab it before ref can see it. And he fights harder when his mouthpiece comes out.
Stop! No punch. Break. Get over there. Time! Princess, quick. Next time you do that, I gotta take a phone call, okay? I know it's an accident. Here we go, but you gotta keep that. Stop blowing it out. Here we go. Box, time in!
Tell you guys, I fight with my mouth open, but I have a mouthpiece that fits my mouth and my teeth, so there's nothing that's gonna knock it out. And
10 seconds.
Gomez doesn't have that, and he fights with his mouth open. That's why the mouthpiece comes out.
Gomez just missed with that overhand right that bounced off the shoulder of Sabio. Another good round for Brian Sabio.
Deep breath, Brian. Deep breath. Nice all over the place.
Yes, I'll get you. No round, baby. Come on.
Face is good, man. Just breathe.
Woo! Hey, like that, huh? Come on, baby. Finish strong. Finish strong, baby.
That's good. We can wipe it up.
We got some water. Finish strong, baby. He's tired. You want to win, dig.
Yeah, look good. Okay? Come on.
Hey, Sean, you know, Gomez told us he thought Sabio was going to do a lot of running, but Sabio has not, and he is dug deep in tight.
You know, I think Gomez made a good assumption because Sabio's a good boxer, but we see here going to the body and breaking down the Gomez here was the perfect game plan. And I'm not sure it was a game plan. I think it was just something that he and his corner recognized he needed to do.
Last round, we're going to touch gloves, gentlemen.
Brian Sabio will turn 27 on February
touch
the 28th.
Here we go.
Box. 10th and final round begins.
Like it. Touch gloves. Sabio says, good work, buddy. He's appreciative of the work, not only by himself, but his opponent as well. A lot of respect between these two.
Sabio's willingness to fight in the pocket seems to show you he wanted to impress. He wanted to get a finish. Do you think he takes a little bit too much in return paying that price here, Sean?
Yeah, he definitely takes a little bit too much in return. You can see he's got some bruises underneath both eyes, actually. And one thing he can improve on, along with his strength and power, is being able to stay in that pocket but be defensive in the pocket.
I'm going to check in with Curran in the corner of Larry Gomez.
Uncle and trainer for Larry Gomez has had the same instructions the last few rounds. He wants Larry to start with speed, end with power. They feel like they're losing the fight, but that's the only adjustment they want their fighter to make. Start with speed, end with power. Back to you guys.
Well, when it comes to adjustments, you have to make adjustments based on the abilities that your fighter has. And I think they understand that. My fighter's fast, but he's strong. So we got to finish with more punches, but we still got to continue to be aggressive. That's the only thing he can do.
We saw number four where Gomez did touch the chin of Sabio. Good combination to the body there by Gomez, but then Sabio finished that sequence off with a good punch of his own.
Sabio's good. He's either going to catch you coming or catch you leaving. And that's pretty impressive, too, at this point, seeing a young kid be able to throw the punches necessary to control the fight. I can tell you guys that I have seen Sabio's endurance and power decrease as the fight went on. Yep, there goes the mouthpiece again. But that's a part of the game, you know, not the mouthpiece, the digression of his power and strength. But it'll come better. It'll get better as he progresses in the sport.
Yeah, that's a point deducted from Sabio for spitting it out. That's the fifth time it's come out.
Here we go. Time in. Let's go. Box.
Yeah, that seals the deal. And with 1 minute left, as Sabio, box, be smart. But as Gomez, we should see him be more aggressive now at this point.
Two left hooks for Gomez land flush.
Sean, if you're Sabio, knowing that you're in control, why stay here right now?
You know, the thing I was talking about, momentum. sometimes backing up gives a guy momentum, you know, and so he doesn't want to back up. He doesn't want to give Gomez space. Of course, you give Gomez space to land a punch, but even beyond that, you don't want him to have a chance to let his hands go. Stand close, smother him, let go your hands when you need to, and get out of the fight safely.
One of the better rounds for Larry Gomez, but he had a point deducted. For the mouthpiece.
Very good boxing match. Very good boxing match.
Really was a good boxing match. But it looks like Brian Ceballo had the superior skill. And remember, Gomez, who had one of his better rounds in round 10, loses a point because of the mouthpiece. Gomez tried to push the action in the final round, but Brian Ceballo, the sharper of the two. We'll get the judge's decision when we return. Coming in, they had a combined 14 knockouts, but we await the decision for Brian Ceballo and Larry Gomez. Lupe Contreras has the judges' scorecards with our decision.
After going all 10 rounds here at the Wild Card Boxing Club, we consult the official scorecard to determine a winner. Judge Guillermo scores it 96-93. Judge Stevens, 98-91. And Judge DeLuca scores it 99-90. All three in favor of the winner by way of unanimous decision. And now, WBO Intercontinental Welterweight Champion from Brooklyn, New York, Brian Ceballo.
Brian Ceballo, a unanimous decision, improves to 12-0 as he defeats Larry Gomez in. Certainly showed off a lot of different skills, Sean.
A very good boxing match and a very good boxer in Ceballo. He was able to set up punches, punch on the inside, fight from the outside, use a great jab. I mean, he was able to touch Gomez with jabs that I didn't even know he had. Right there, we see him slip and go to the body. Very prolific tonight by Ceballo. He was aggressive when he needed to be aggressive, took the fight to Gomez, and took the belt home.
Brian Ceballo, 26 years of age, out of Brooklyn, New York, owns Bout Fight Club in the Financial District, co-owner with trainer Colin Morgan, comes up with the victory. Well, the gloves are laced. Everybody's taped up and ready to go. You're going to get a look at young prospect Gorit Yuritsian taking on Mahonry Montez. at 148 pounds on Ring City Boxing USA.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, take it. Let me hold this. I'll hold this. There you go. Let me hold this.
Gotcha.
Back in Los Angeles for another installment of Ring City USA on NBCSN. And the setting and the backdrop, perfect place for it. Wild Card Boxing Club, founded by that man, Hall of Famer Freddie Roach, who's getting ready to step into the ring with one of his young prospects, Gor Yuritsian, who hails from Armenia. Freddie liked what he saw when Gor came in to work out at the beginning of 2019. Asked him if he had a trainer. He said no. Said, I'd be more than willing to work with you. I love your work ethic. And speaking of loving work ethic, when our own Sean Porter came into the Wildcard Boxing Club, Freddie liked the way Sean worked, and he invited him to the Philippines, worked with Manny Pacquiao. And for more on the story, here's Sean with what Wildcard Boxing Club is truly all about.
Well, here's the tunnel, the entrance to the wild card. And you know, when you're a kid and you go through a tunnel, you hold your breath. You don't know what's on the other side. And that's how I was. I didn't hold my breath, but I didn't know what was on the other side. But two things, hard work and the grind. Right here is where my grind began, at the wild card, eating lunch here, hanging out here, opposed to going back to the hotel. There was nothing at the hotel for me, but right here was home. This is where everybody wants to be in boxing. If you're a professional boxer, especially in the California area, you're coming right here to the wild card. And I was able to come here when I was young in my professional career. And the funny thing is, when you come to the wild card, that's where you start. Over here is where the small boxing ring is, and that's where the amateurs are and the guys that are just getting started. Right here, this is where you want to be. This is where I wanted to be. When I was over there, I made it a goal of mine to be right here, boxing in front of Freddie Roach. And I was able to do that. Freddie saw me, thought I looked good, took me to the Philippines, got to hang out with Manny Pacquiao, enjoy myself over there, but grow in the sport of boxing. Of course, when I came back here, this is where I belong. This was my new home right here in this boxing ring where a lot of professional champions perform in front of Freddie Roach. And another funny story, the best story, one of the best stories that I have in boxing, is that Freddie, right here, he told me one day I would be a world champion. And I looked at him, I said, I don't know if he's serious. But I made it a goal of mine that one day I would win a championship title. And I bring it right here. Set it right here, and I showed it to Freddie Roach. I looked at him, I said, remember you told me one day I would win one of these? He said, yeah, I did, and you did it.
And I was very proud, and it made me understand exactly who Freddie Roach is, a guy who has a lot of compassion and love for the sport and everyone that he works with. And that's what you get when you come here to the Wild Card Boxing Club.
Not only has Freddie built a lot of great champions, but you think of the countless young men that Freddie has had a chance to work with that maybe didn't become world champions, but took the lessons they learned in the Wild Card Boxing Club, took them out into the real world, and wound up having successful lives in other businesses and being good family people. Freddie Roach has certainly left his mark in over 25 years here at the Wild Card Boxing Club. Freddie's going to be in the corner with another young prospect, Gorit Yuritsian, when we return to Ring City USA on NBCSN. Get so excited, the new original series, Saved by the Bell, is streaming now exclusively on Peacock. Bayside is back with new students, new stories, and some very familiar faces. Sign up at peacock.com and start streaming now. One of the great kickoffs to the holiday season last night, the tree lighting ceremony at Rockefeller Center. As we welcome you back to the Wild Card Boxing Club, Ring City USA. Here on NBCSN. Let's take a look at the tail of the tape for Gorit Yuritsian, 25 years of age. Mahonry Montez, 31 years of age. You see Montez rehydrated up to 164 pounds. Slight height advantage for Montez. For the introductions, here's Lupe Contreras.
We continue with the action here at the Wild Card Boxing Club, Hollywood, California. This is Ring City USA, presented in association with Batch Boxing and Punch Boxing Promotions. This bout set for a distance of 8 rounds or less in the welterweight division. Our judges at ringside are Max DeLuca, Ron Scott Stevens, and Ivan Guillermo. At the sound of the bell, the man in charge of the ring, referee Jack Reese. Presenting first, the fighter in the blue corner. He enters the ring wearing silver with gold trim. His official weight, 148 pounds in 47 professional bouts. He maintains a record of 36 victories against 9 losses, 1 draw, 25 of those victories coming by way of KO. Representing Los Mochis, Sinaloa, Mexico, Mahonry Rusito Monte. Across the ring in the red corner, wearing purple trunks with silver and white trim, he weighed in at an identical 148 pounds tonight. He puts his undefeated record on the line, consisting of 13 victories, 11 of those victories coming by way of knockout. Representing Yerevan, Armenia, Gorit Yuritsian.
Right here, Gor. Okay, mouthpiece. I gave you both instructions in the dress room. You acknowledge you both speak enough English. That's what I'll use primarily. Trunks are good. Fight hard, fight clean. Listen, obey my commands all the time. Protect yourself. Good luck.
So Goryaritsyan set to go. Sparred at the wild card gym. He was in with a six rounder with a Mexican fighter, and Freddie Roach loved his tenacity and his work ethic, and that's how the two teamed up to start 2019. That's round number one underway.
That's exactly what you're going to see from Gore. You're going to see tenacity and hard work. He's not going to wait. He's going to maintain a good pace against Montez.
You know, Montez has the nickname Russo Jr.
Yeah.
It's a funny story because he has no Russian descent in his background. But his dad was a fighter, Jose Montez, and he resembled a little Ivan Drago, and he picked up the little Russian moniker, although he kind of chuckled when we brought it up to him at the fighter meetings.
Yeah, I think it's pretty cool. It's based on his boxing style. You know, he's going to stand right there in front of Gore and try to press him all night. And I guess it reminds a lot of people of that Russian style that Drago had in that Rocky movie.
Good jab there by Yuritsyan. Earlier, he had connected with a good hook, the left hand.
I haven't seen enough Armenian fighters to know if they have a certain style or a certain way to fight, but right off the bat, seeing his jab and the snapping and the hands are down, I got a feeling that that's something a lot of the Armenians do.
Freddie Roach watching Gore Yuritsyan. Well, you have Victor Chinian and Arthur Abraham, of Armenian descent, guys that have won world titles.
Yeah, Vanez is someone I watched coming when I was going for the Olympic Games. He fought in the quad right before me. And one weight class below mine, I believe. And so I know Vanez very well. I've seen Vanez. I've never sparred with Vanez.
Stop. Separate from each other.
But separate. That is something I know about the Armenian fighters. They're rough and hard and rugged. They're going to fight hard for however long the fight is. This would be an eight round.
Usually a lot of depth.
Let each other go. Let each other go. Come on, your hands are free, fellas. Work at it, I think.
As well.
Stop. Separate from each other. Box.
Artur Gregorian, another WBO lightweight champion.
Go rips to the body well. Big left hook to the body there, and then a straight jab to the body.
Puts his hands together. End of round number one, scheduled for eight. Let's send it over to BC.
Thanks, Bob. Here with a little bit of wild card royalty, the Hawaiian Punch, former two-division champion, Brian Viloria. 10 years Freddie Roach was in your corner. How integral was that relationship to your career?
It was amazing. I was coming out of the Olympics. This was my first home. So I moved here from Hawaii, and Freddie Roach took me from an amateur standout into becoming a world champion. I think I was one of his first fighter. I think I'm probably the only one that he took from the amateur division all the way to the professional ranks and winning a world title. So this was a big part of my professional boxing history, and this is, you know, giving me back great memories being here.
Real quick, you've had a great career. You're transitioning to the training game now. How often do you hear Coach Freddie in your head as you're talking to your fighter?
All the time. I mean, you know, he grew me from being an amateur fighter into a professional fighter, and you know, and into becoming a world champion. So a lot of that I've taken into my training regimen and teaching these fighters straight from Freddie Roach himself.
Always great to see the Hawaiian Punch in person. Back to you, Bob.
Yeah, he was the 1999 USA Boxer of the Year, having won the National Amateur Championship at 106 pounds. He won the 1999 National Golden Gloves and won the 1999 World Amateur Championship as well.
Yeah,
quite a year.
2000 was the Olympic quad he was on, and that was one of my favorite Olympic teams to watch. I remember looking up to those guys. And, you know, Freddie, the history of boxing has to be handed down. I think Freddie has chosen an excellent pupil
and the Hawaiian punch.
So when we talked to Montez yesterday, he said, look, I got to fight my style. Not kidding anybody. The Mexican style from Los Mochis. Pressure, pressure, pressure. Where's the pressure right now?
Well, it's there. He's walking Gore down, even though he's wearing some punches coming in. Gore is starting to slow down a little bit and take steps back, and that's what Montez wants.
Let's go to Kern in the corner of Gore Yerisian.
Of course, the legendary Freddie Roach in the red corner with Gore Yerisian. The instructions after round one, double jab, right hand, be first. You are the boss in there. You control this fight. Don't let him take control of this fight. So both stylistic advice and also
let
motivational
advice. Let him go, Gore, that's you holding.
Great
Gore,
Freddie
your
Roach.
Left arm,
back
let him go. Pull your arms out of there, let each other go. Montes, let him go. Suéltelo. Stop, stop, stop. Come on, guys, let each other go.
Definitely not going to disagree with Freddie Roach. I think that what he means by don't allow him to get control is even though you're stepping back, even though you're boxing, keep letting your hands go and keep touching this guy.
Freddie loves the work ethic he's seen in Gore Yerisian. And here's a guy who came from Armenia in a good amateur program with a decent foundation. He has a victory over Brian Zabayo, who we just saw in the fight before be victorious in Germany few years back by decision, said he respects Ceballos' game as a good boxer, but it was Yerisian who got the judge's nod.
That's pretty impressive, man. That could be a match we see down the line. I'm not the matchmaker here, but I'm just saying.
Ooh. I'm in. Let's do it.
I love the body attack by Gore. I like to see more of that. He's digging down. Solarplex shots. I haven't seen any liver shots yet, but definitely the solarplex and a wide hook coming right around the right glove of Montez.
Let each other out. Come on. Your arms are free, fellas. Gore, let him go.
Come to the end of round number two. Gore Yerisian. Three-punch combination there to the torso
Time.
Of Montez.
Stop punch.
Freddie Roach has to likely see so far out of his young protege from Armenia.
Very good uppercut, and then the follow-up with the right hand. Pick a guy's head up, and then you finish it off with a straight punch. Gore's his punch selection is what I like out of him tonight. I love the body attack and the punches to the head. He's throwing a wide hook to come around the right glove of Montez, and then he's throwing jabs just like that. You cannot abandon the jab.
Round number three scheduled for 8.
And then there's defense, and I like it. He's stepping around, he's using the whole ring. A lot of people think that if the guy who's being aggressive is the guy who's controlling the ring, but sometimes when you can use the ring and use defense, you're the guy, in fact, who's controlling the ring.
Stop, I break, step
well,
away
you
from
use
each other.
Your opponent's aggression against them, ultimately, and there's a lot to like, certainly, about Yerisian's game. I was talking to Freddie Roach earlier. Kind of reminds me, as a stand-up, strong counterpuncher, good boxer, of Victor Postol, the very talented 140-pound contender who Freddie has trained in recent fights.
Yeah.
Freddie agreed. He's got that Eastern European toughness for sure, but
Stop.
Also
I
very
break.
Polished,
away from each other.
Nice counterpunching, knows what he's doing in there.
And I've seen that from Freddie. Freddie works with guys who have the same type of styles. I think for Freddie, it kind of makes sense to him. He knows what he got out of that guy. He's going to be able to pull that out of you, too. That's what he's doing with Gordon.
Blood from the nose of Montez. Good combination, and then a good jab by Yerisian.
Montez is strong, man. He's eating these punches, and he's continuing to come forward.
Montez is a fighter. He's been in there with some very big names, but I think he doesn't move his head enough when he comes in. The times that he does it, he is very dangerous because he can let punches go quickly in small spaces. But if he's going to walk in a straight line, he's going to be wide open for these right hands.
I'm not sure what the disconnect is there, because when you're able to make a guy miss and then throw punches, you kind of want to do that every time you can do it, you know? So why would you just walk up on the guy the way that Montez chooses to do? And big counters right there, kind of right hand in the left hook.
Sometimes, Sean, it is in the water. We know that Montez from Los Mochis in Sinaloa, Mexico. You want to talk about a reputation, the Jorge Arces, the Fernando Montiels of the world, and that's just two of them. Yep. Mexican style, we like to use as a slang term. Yep. It's
stop.
Come forward.
And break. Step away from each
eat
other.
Two or three to box. Land your two or three of your own. It is the Mexican way in many ways.
Yep. And I guess the question now is, can Montez land those shots, and can he continue to take the punishment that he's taking? That right there, simple boxing. Off four of those punches landed. He threw a jab and then
Gore,
a hook right
out.
Off of the jab.
Let each other
then
go.
He threw a
work
right
at
hand
it. Come
and
on,
then another
your
jab.
Hands are free. Push off
that's
each
good
other.
Boxing.
Push off each other.
Another strong round for Gore Yerichian.
Big strike right hand, and counter left hook. And he beats his chest and keeps walking.
Pretty dominant time. Performance for Yerichian. Back to the corner of Freddie Roach, who's trained a lot of great champions like Amir Khan.
Hey, Dad. My message to Freddie would be like, thank you, first of all, for helping me, building me, and making me the fighter I am. I remember one time when he was cutting my bandages, and he ended up cutting my finger, inside my finger. And he said to me, he said, don't worry about it because you're the second person I've cut. And I go, who was the first person you cut? And he says, that was Klitschko. And he became a world champion afterwards. And I was like, oh, well, thanks for that, Freddie. Freddie, he's a superstar. And still being a superstar and still being the first in the gym and the last one out, credit goes out to him because there's not many people out there like him who are so dedicated to the sport of boxing.
Amir Khan held the WBA. Title from 2009 to 2012.
Number four.
IBF title,
number
2011.
Stay back, guys. Stay back.
One of the many greats to come out of the Wild Card Boxing Club under the tutelage of Freddie Roach.
Freddie has taken a lot of very good fighters, and he made them great. Right there, Amir Khan was definitely one of those fighters.
That's it.
These are hard shots Gore Yerichian is landing, and you're seeing he's sitting down on them a little bit more, adding a little bit of the miles per hour to the fastball here. It feels like he sees an opening in Montez.
Yep, and right now it's just about a matter of the distance and the range. And when you see him use his feet, he just got to create that distance and that range. Right there, the jab, about three or four of them, was simply to keep that range right there.
Steve Smoker giving
all three
rounds
I'll take a look at it in a minute.
Gore Yerichian.
No arguments from me.
I think if you were a Montez family member, it would be hard to disagree with that score at this point.
Stop. Don't push him down. Come here, man. Okay. Box. It's coming from the inside, it looks.
Talking about the left ear of Montez. There's obviously blood coming from his nose as well. Oh, good left, right. And then Yerichian puts them together.
Wow. And he shakes his head, and then he just gets right back on his trot to come forward.
That can be the universal sign, Sean, for that hurt me a lot, even though I'm telling you it didn't.
Not with Montez. With Montez, he's just letting you know, like, hey, I'm still here. He's saying I'm not hurt. He's saying I'm still
him
here,
out.
You know?
Stop, my break.
Most times that's what it means. It means I felt you touch me, and I'm still here, but this time, Montez means business. You know, I don't think he has the boxing ability to keep up with Gore.
Certainly proven track record of toughness, though. We talked about his father earlier, Jose Luis Montes, former fighter himself, at 48 pro fights. Juan Manuel Marquez in 1994, lost by knockout in Mexico City. A little bit of a journeyman 140-pounder, but wow. He was tough as nails. He has great hair, as we know, our own Curran Batia showcasing all the time around here.
Stop, there it break. Is. The pack.
What does Gore need to do? I would say go to the body. You got a guy who's taking everything you got to the head. Keep going to the body.
Pumps out the jab, lands both. Combination to the head. Oh. Uppercut, big up. Lands. There's the body shots.
There you go. Gore has so many tools from that mid-range stance. He can hit you with the uppercut. He can put together combinations.
And he can step around. He can find an angle and throw an uppercut. I like to see him stay greedy like he is this round. Moving forward, he might get a knockout.
Dominant fourth round for Gore Yerichian.
Hey, Doc, come on up. No, in a second, when he gets to the ring.
Big uppercut.
Time out, Rich.
I want to see more of that this next round.
Hey, Doc, come here a second.
The
other side. The other side. The other side. I don't know if it's inside or just a scrape or from the nose. Couldn't tell.
Montes is taking a lot of punishment. Ringside physician taking a look at the cuts.
Cut on the inside of the ear. That's where the equilibrium is. So you got to be mindful of that. You got to let the judges and referees and doctors do their job.
No, I was. I saw blood in it. So, okay, we're good. I'm just going to get him out of here. I can't let the, you know what I mean?
I think Jack Reese is a very good referee.
You got plenty of time. You got plenty of time.
He's very responsible, watch both fighters in the ring, bit. And I
okay,
appreciate
want,
that about
push
him.
Push him out of there and you can move away, but don't keep there.
I don't think this is a.
So
let's listen to Jack.
He's telling him this. You're fighting valiantly. You're giving your all. But I can't.
See, 3 minutes of
waiting in there. If he's not, if that, this that, is going to go on, I'm going to end up stopping. Okay.
Estás peleando bien valiente, pero estás.
Combination, the hook right hand, beautiful.
Here's beautiful. What I can say about that. I mean, I think sports in general is starting to move in a different direction where we're taking care of our athletes. We see it a lot now in football where some time ago, certain hits, you're like, oh, that was clean.
Number five.
It's not
single.
Clean anymore. And the same thing goes for boxing. Even though this kid, okay. Montes, is coming forward, he wants to fight. He's fighting valiantly. He's in a dangerous position now. His ear is bleeding. He hasn't won a round. And Jack is like, show me something this round or I'm going to stop it. Got to take care of the fighters.
And that's smart.
Yeah,
that is smart.
Take care of the fighters.
Round number five begins, all Yerichian.
We saw that earlier tonight with the female fight. The girl lost three rounds. There's nothing you can do. Stop the fight and live the fight another day. And if you're Gore, you recognize that the referee is worried. Give him something to be concerned about. Put your foot on the gas pedal, get greedy, and start letting your hands go.
That shows you the knowledge and maturity in Yerichian. And he's not coming out here with soft jabs. He's coming out here to end the fight right now.
Stop. Oh, what are you punching?
Yeah, I think
turn
right
around.
Now he's just being patient
box.
To find that big moment. I expect to see a moment in this round.
Yerichian has been able to control the pace of this fight, dictate the terms, control the ring.
Oh, big right hand.
Good right hand, right to the face of Montes.
Interesting enough, a guy in Montes, you can't make a guy miss, but you choose to put your hands down, not carry them above, at your face so that you can block them.
Brandon Adams. Sonny Duverson coming up in our main event.
You hear Freddie say, back him up. Freddie knows what time it is.
These are hard, clean right hands. Gore is landing one after another.
It's not, Gore is not just touching him. He's hitting Montez. Every punch counts at this point, too.
Let's see if Urizi in here in the final 40 seconds of round number five picks up the pace just a little bit more and gives Jack Reese more to think about. Good combination there.
You're just not seeing any attempt to go to the body from Montez. It's doing nothing to slow down this big train in front of him.
Yeah. And the big weapon for Gore is a 1-2 and a right hand.
Counter right followed by a left. Another right gets in there.
This could be the last round for Montez.
Yeah, I mean, at this point.
Yeah, Jack is not going to let you just play with the fighter. He's gonna look out for that fighter, understanding that he won't win a round. He won't win the fight.
Time. Oh, yeah. Hey, roll.
He was gonna stop it, and then he wanted to get him one more last round.
Okay. Number six. You haven't landed any punches on him. You understand what I'm saying?
No,
you know him better than me. He hasn't landed any punches.
One more round.
All right. You start taking punches, it's over. You understand?
Okay.
All right.
Everybody, come here, okay? All right, he's ready to go home. Let's go right now. You're looking really good.
15 seconds off. Clear the rank.
Thank you, by the way.
Good job.
Six.
Well, you got one six. Guy in one corner saying one more round. I'm really wondering what he's going to do in this round, but then you got Freddie Roach saying, let's go. We should get some action here.
Well, hey guys, you know, sometimes you've got to protect the athlete from themselves, and we know where Montez is from, Los Mochis, and sort of the style of fighting pressure of the Mexican fighter. And
Stop.
Yep, there it is.
That's it. Jack Reese was not going to let it continue. Great stop.
Warrior, brother. You're warrior.
That was a surgical, clinical assault from Gore Urizen.
Man. I honestly, man, I don't say this just because I know Jack and he's worked my fights. I really do appreciate Jack Reese as a ref. I've watched him in other fights. I watch a lot of the other refs, watch them do the things, and I just think that Jack is one of the best at it. You see him jump in right there. Gore got caught clean. He's been getting caught clean the whole fight. But right there in that moment is where his knees finally buckled. But Jack's right there for him.
Gore Urizen improves to 14-0, gets his 12th stoppage. We'll get the official time of the stoppage as he dominates Montez here at the Wild Card Boxing Club, Ring City, USA on NBCSN. Have you been feeling like a cave person this year? You're not alone. America's favorite prehistoric family, The Croods, is back and funnier than ever. The hilarious new DreamWorks animated comedy, The Croods, a new age, starring Nicolas Cage, Emma Stone, and Ryan Reynolds. In theaters now. It's worth leaving your cave for, we promise. And it's certainly worth coming to L.A. and the Wild Card Boxing Club for Ring City USA here on NBCSN. Impressive performance by Gore Yerizian. For the official time of the stoppage, here's Lupe Contreras.
An accumulation of punches forces referee Jack Reese to step in and call a halt to the action with an official time of 18 seconds of round number 6, declaring the winner by way of knockout, still undefeated, Gore Yerizian. Ready.
Gore Yerizian, now 14-0, 12th stoppage. Fourth fight with Freddie Roach here in 2019.
Thank you,
man.
Good to see you. Thanks, guys.
And really tremendous performance. He dominated the fight from start to finish. Accurate with his punching, sharp, and Montez took a lot of punishment. And Freddie Roach, who has taken many young fighters and crafted them into champions, certainly impressed with what he saw out of Gore Yerizian here tonight as he goes out and dominates the bout. Well, coming up, our main event, Brandon Adams, 21-3 with 13 knockouts, taking on Sonny Duverson, taking the fight on short notice, but he's a live wire. It's all coming up next on NBCSN and Ring City USA. Welcome back to the Wild Card Boxing Club, Ring City USA, here on NBCSN. And part of the protocols, takes about 7 minutes to sterilize and clean the ring between each and every fight as we get set for our main event here this evening between Brandon Adams and Sonny Duverson. Let's go back up into the Wild Card Boxing Club and welcome in Kern.
Brandon Adams did not have an easy upbringing. He grew up in the dangerous neighborhoods between Compton and Watts. He credits getting out of that situation to faith and what he calls a courageous sense of humor. Eventually, that drive and that ambition led him to find boxing. And he ascended all the way up to challenging himself against one of the toughest fighters in the sport, Jermall Charlo. But that fight was not without personal turmoil. I went down to speak with Brandon Adams about that situation.
Right before I went to go fight Jermall Charlo, my son was born emergency. My wife had my son during a 7 month versus 9 to 10 months. I'm talking about she might need a blood transfusion. So I'm kind of stressed about this, and my flight is literally like 3 days away. My wife telling me, hey, you don't worry about this over here. And I'm, yeah, right, of course.
4-12.
It's one of the situations where you just kind of got to do it. Like, because if you stop, then everything around you stop. Then if you stop, then your family don't, you know, you don't make the money. you stop your legacy.
And with everything going on, you stepped in the ring, you didn't go down, you made it to the distance. Do you think of that as an accomplishment, that you were able to go the distance with one of the best fighters in the game?
I'm not gonna lie to you, no. I'm going up in there with the intentions on beating these guys and beating them in fashion. There will always be obstacles, you know, there will always be something to stop you or hinder you, but you gotta push through. You gotta break them walls down. You gotta become more than what you were yesterday, a year ago, an hour ago. That's the only way you're gonna keep progressing.
Tell me about growing up. What was it like?
Growing up in, it was right between Compton and Watts. My grandma stayed in Watts. My mom having 9 kids, and then, you know, she's raising some of her siblings' kids, the community kids. She's everybody's mom. I remember being in first grade, actually. Everybody was saying what they wanted to be when they was growing up. And me, I remember, I was like, I'm gonna be a Power Ranger. And everybody was like, nah, that's just not gonna happen. I said, all right, then fine, I'll be a football player. So I would always be out there playing football, practicing, trying to run drills and do whatever was necessary for me to take those steps to get there. The high school coach didn't give me the opportunity, told me I was too small. There was always a reason why I couldn't be out there on the field. So I was like, how about I get involved in the sport to where I don't have to rely on anybody, to where I can do everything on my own. And that's actually how I got involved in boxing. It was the Fight Night Champions, the video game. It was always remembering who Mike Tyson was. You know, he was a small guy who got everybody's respect. And that kind of drove me in the very beginning of my career until I learned that you don't get no further than what your team is gonna push you.
In his own words, Brandon Adams wants to inspire people tonight. To do that, he's gonna have to get by the taller and longer Sonny Duverson. Let's go inside Wildcard to BC, who's with Sonny.
Here with a very opportunistic Sonny Duverson. Sonny, they say fortune favors the bold. What type of statement are you hoping to make tonight?
Man, I'm trying to make a big statement, man. Let everybody know that I'm here and I'm for real, man. I'm just not taking any and every fight just because.
We know you're a fun fighter. We know you love to fight. Because of the last minute nature of this, it'll be an 8-round main event. Who will that favor?
I believe it'll favor me because I'm more active, so I already know that just to get right back to it. And he has to probably slowly get into the rounds, you know, warm up. So I think I got the bigger advantage on that.
We're about to see what happens inside that ring. Back to Bob and Sean at ringside.
Yeah, Brian, you mentioned Sonny coming off back-to-back losses in October and November, but very competitive fights. And now against Brandon Adams, he's trying to make a statement as we welcome you back to ringside here at the Wild Card Boxing Club. All right, let's talk a little bit about Brandon Adams. He's got to deal with an opponent change. He's got to deal with a guy that's got a big reach. Give me the DNA of Brandon Adams.
The good part about it is his DNA. He's a chameleon. He can do a lot of different things in the ring. Brandon Adams, he likes to be aggressive. He likes to use his jab, but he also likes to use the whole ring. He's got very good feet and very good defense. He can use the ring, but he can also be aggressive. Let me remind you, his boxing name, the Cannon. He can explode. There are going to be moments in this fight where he's going to find Sonny, and he's going to try to release a big overhand right or a big left hook and try to end the night.
How does he negate the reach advantage that Sonny Duverson is going to have in this fight?
The good part about it, as it pertains to Brandon, is he's got good feet. He can use the ring and he can get out of the way of the distance, and he's also very quick and explosive with his feet, so he's able to get in and probably negate the reach of Sonny Duverson.
All right, so Sonny Duverson is an incredible story, incarcerated for 5 years, says, I can't let opportunities pass anymore. He said, in boxing, this sport has no ceiling, and I'm ready to go to the top. What's his DNA as a fighter?
That kid is a bully, a straight bully. He's going to walk down Brandon Adams tonight. He's going to try to use his jab and find that reach on that distance, land overhand right. You see him right here. He's just a worker. He's a workhorse, and he's a bully. He's going to push back Brandon Adams. He's going to try to walk him down and just try to let his hands go. Overhand rights. That's what Sonny Duverson is about. He's got a lot of power in his right hand.
And he's certainly got a lot of confidence, too. As we had a chance to talk with him, he feels really confident about how he's going to go into that. And that's part of it, right, having that mindset.
Absolutely. When you're a guy who's taking last-minute fights, that confidence is what gets you in the ring. And then his power is what's going to help him through this fight.
All right, that's coming up at our main event here this evening here on NBCSN. Brandon Adams squaring off against Sonny Duverson. Sonny Duverson, well, he's not worried about anything. He's ready to take this fight to Adams. Brandon Adams, on the other hand, he's ready to put on a show and impress the crowd. Our main event coming up next here on NBCSN. We're in Hollywood and the Wild Card Boxing Club, Ring City, USA, here on NBCSN as we get set for the main event this evening. Brandon Adams, boy, that is some face mask. Eight rounds at 156 pounds. That's going to be an interesting ring walk. Sonny Duverson, he doesn't care about any of that. He's ready to go in and get some work done. We're set for the main event. Let's get the final word from both Adams and Duverson.
I'm looking very much forward to fighting this guy.
You're gonna see an exciting fight from start to finish.
I'm gonna make this moment mine. I know I'm one of the best fighters in the world. When everything is right, that's my night.
I came in here to do one job and one job only, and that's to knock him out.
It's gonna be different for me because I'm the difference maker.
I'm the equalizer. My right hand is reality, so he can say whatever.
I don't care about who he fought. I just know who I am, and I know what I'm capable of.
He needs to be ready for a war. I'm leaving it all in the ring. Somebody's getting knocked out.
Entering the ring, in the blue corner, Sonny Primetime Duverson.
Sonny Duverson started boxing at the age of 9, didn't take it seriously until 2017. Spent 5 years incarcerated, and he realized that he had wasted a lot of time and a lot of opportunities in his life, and he said, wasn't gonna let that pass me by. Took a bunch of odd jobs, was working at Taco Bell and other establishments, but every time he was due for a promotion, his background, his past caught up with him and his record. And he said, one of the things that really drove me to focus on boxing is there are no ceilings in this sport. I control my own destiny, and he'll try to do that tonight.
Nice job, Dan Martin, nice job. Can I just see, you got it right there.
In the red corner.
No, you don't need it, man. Go get some rubber.
Brandon Cannon Adams.
Yeah. And I know what everybody at home is thinking. What is this guy wearing?
compliments of SMF, Styles Make Fights. It's a new boxing apparel company that's new on the scene, and they're trying to explode. They wanted to do it right here with Brandon Adams. This is Brandon the Cannon Adams. He's rocking the Super Mario Brothers. You play that, Brian?
I did back in the day. I will say, you can't pull this outfit off unless you have the abs to back it up right here. I mean, come on.
And the music to back it up. You dropped the bomb on me. I love it.
Rough upbringing in Los Angeles, but he has fought the odds, married to his wife, Erica. He's got three kids. He said not only is it about being a great role model, an athlete trying to win a championship, but it's setting an example for future generations, paying it forward. That's what he wants to do here tonight.
Do you have the mouthpiece? I can see it.
The mouthpiece.
Let's take a look at the tail of the tape as they try to find the mouthpiece. They got the mask. They need the mouthpiece.
Uh-oh.
Adams and Duverson both weighing in at 156 pounds. You see Adams is rehydrated to 165. Duverson to 175 pounds, and the big number just on your lower right there, Duverson with a reach of 80 inches to Adams 71. Time for the formal introductions. Back to the ring and Lupe Contreras.
We continue with the action here at the house that Freddie built. The Wild Card Boxing Club, Hollywood, California. This is Ring City USA in association with Bash Boxing, Banner Promotions, and Tournament of Champions. And now, ladies and gentlemen, prepare to be entertained. This is the main event of the evening, set for 8 rounds in the super welterweight division. Our judges scoring at ringside are Max DeLuca, Ron Scott Stevens, and Ivan Guillermo. At the bell, the ref in charge of the ring is Jack Reese. Presenting first, the fighter in the blue corner. He enters the ring wearing white with silver and gold. He weighed in at an official 156 pounds. Tonight, he answers the call and enters the ring for the 16th time as a pro with 11 victories against 2 losses, 2 draws, 8 of those victories coming by way of KO. Sonny Primetime Duverson. Across the ring in the red corner, wearing multicolored trunks with black trim, he weighed in at an identical 156 pounds. In his 25th professional bout, he enters the ring with an outstanding record of 21 victories against 3 losses, 13 of those victories coming by way of KO. The winner of season 5, The Contender, fighting out of the city of Watts, LA, California, Brandon the Cannon Adams.
Get your mouthpiece. Thank you, sir. Let me see. That's good. Never mind. Brandon, right here, you want to take that thing off?
Yeah, we'll take this off. Yeah.
Get your mouthpiece. Good.
Dick.
It's okay, man.
Hey, Sean, this is why Terrell was supposed to be in here.
Should have went the other
way. You want to be all nice. Right.
Your trunks are just a teeny bit high. No, it's okay, man. I'm going to let them just work right around the top of it. You got your mouthpiece. I said both instructions. I want to remind you, please listen and follow my instructions. Protect yourself at all times. Good luck. Touch.
We talked about Brandon Adams and the rough upbringing and now a husband and father of 4 kids. And he said, look, I wake up every day trying to figure out what I might have done wrong the day before and how I can make it right today.
Brandon, you ready?
He takes his job and his role very seriously. And obviously, he wants to continue to share that message with people, and having a chance to win a world championship certainly would broaden his platform. Round number one underway.
Wardrobe malfunction behind us, Sean, okay?
Yeah.
Bowser had a little trouble there, but now let's get back to boxing.
That wasn't good. But, hey, listen, look. Records can be deceiving. We got 21-3 in the ring, and then we got 11-2-2 in the ring. But these guys have more skills and more talent than their records reflect. And we'll see that very quickly.
Well, Duverson is fresh off two defeats. It's hard to ignore that. But these were two fights in which he was elevated significantly due to his performance, where he said the phone rang more after each of those defeats because of how well he fought than at any point before in his career.
Yeah, you think about his October 9th loss in Las Vegas to Lorenzo Simpson. He actually dropped Simpson in the fight, lost a unanimous decision, and then split decision loss in November to Booker. And it took that fight on short notice. And you like what you saw in that fight, Sean?
I did. I thought that he worked very well. A lot like this fight right here. I think it took him about two rounds to get started in that fight. And he can't wait much longer to get going in this fight. They only got eight rounds, so he's got to work.
Boy, I love what Adams did right there, doubling up with the hooks to the body.
And sure, yeah, let's go back to his DNA real quick. I talked about him being a chameleon just in the sense that he can do a lot of different things. You can see him on the outside using the jab right there. And then you can also see that he's explosive and can get to the body.
Work out there, let each other go. Work out. Pull your arm through, Brian. Brandon. There you go.
And this was the big thing with Duverson is don't smother your work. You need space. You got long arms. You got power, but you need you got to connect at the end of the punch.
Well, Duverson's going to have to show us something interesting because he talked a lot in the fighter meeting about he's got this 10-inch reach advantage.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if you don't use it, so he certainly wants to work behind his jab.
Yeah.
But if you've seen Sonny Duverson fight before, he fights so much better at close range.
Yeah.
He's going to have to prove that from distance, he can still get off and land the big power shots.
I'm friends with Brandon. I'll be honest, I want to see him win this fight. He's been in plenty of my camps, and he's a good friend of mine. But
his head,
with
Sonny,
Duverson,
let him go, Sonny.
My thing with Duverson is I've seen you work and you're a good fighter. So I shared some information with him. I said, hey, don't abandon your jab. Use your jab. And he said, I intend to. I want to see you use your jab tonight, Duverson.
What kind of friend are you, Sean? You can't give advice to the enemy. Come on.
No, I don't do that, man. I try my best not to pick sides. Again, I do want to see my friend win, but I want to see a great fight. I want to see both these guys be successful.
The body work punching. And then a response by Duverson at the end of round number one. Adams taking on Duverson. That's not who he was supposed to fight. For more on that, here's Kern.
I spoke to Serhii Bohachuk, who, of course, tested positive for COVID. He's on the road to recovery. When I asked him how he's feeling, he said, I'm at about a 7 or 8 out of 10. He calls this experience the hardest of his life. The hardest part, calling his family in the Ukraine and saying, I won't be fighting in this main event. But tonight, he is a very interested observer. He wants to fight the best. And in his mind, that is the winner of this fight. So he's actually watching at home tonight, very interested. Now, if you spent time with Serhii, you know he's a very positive person, always smiling. When I asked him, how are you staying positive during all of this? He said, I'm smiling on the phone right now while talking to you. So Serhii's staying positive, and he wants the winner of this fight. Back to you guys.
Listen, that's what we do as fighters. We move forward, and we look forward to this very next opportunity.
Can't wait to see him in the ring. 18-0 with 18 knockouts. Round number two underway between Adams and Duverson. Great body work by Adams in round number one, testing the conditioning of Duverson.
I think more than testing the conditioning, he's doing what he has to do. It's no secret that he's got to get inside.
Sonny.
5 or 6 inch reach advantage on him. You got to get inside those punches. Good counter hook there.
A little southpaw action from Adams.
I was going
to
say.
You got to love that. And footwork is going to be a key for Adams to get inside, and he's dancing out there on his toes.
I mean, when I pulled the DNA of him being a chameleon, it also came from me not just watching him, but being in the ring with him. You see him switch up. He goes southpaw, and he's back into the body. I mean, he can do a lot of different things in the ring. He's talented, like he said in his preview. When I'm on, I'm a problem for everyone. He is.
And if you've ever seen Brandon Adams fight, he'll gain more confidence if you're not hurting him. If you're not giving him a reason to respect you, he'll throw uppercuts inside. He'll throw combinations. I need to see Sonny Duverson gain that respect right now early in this fight.
Yeah, that's a part of Brandon's personality. He's the kind of guy that he's going to do whatever it takes to win a fight. If he feels you coming on, he's going to work even harder.
Duverson with a hook to the body off the ropes. He landed an uppercut, but
big hook.
big hook.
He's hurt. He's
get
hurt.
Get him up, Brandon.
Now he digs to the body. He does Adams.
Sonny, big left hand.
Duvers is in trouble. And Jack Reese steps in and stops it here in round two.
Dude, you weren't.
Wow.
The cannon. I didn't know.
The cannon.
I didn't know.
We thought he was going to box. He came here to punch.
Sean Porter. I've never been hit with that. Didn't know. Goodness.
Good job by one guy and a tough loss by the other.
What was the theme song he walked into? I'll drop a bomb on you.
You're right. Let me say this. I was thinking, Duvers is not there because he wants to be there. Nor should he be. And he was fighting on the inside. That's kind of where he wants to be, but it's just not where he should be.
So, Brady, come here.
Sonny Duverson had never been down. Stopped for the first time.
And if you think Jack Reese stopped it too soon, look at his feet, look at his legs. He's still light on him. And you can tell that he's still hurt. And even more so, his pride is hurt right now.
Sonny was responsible enough to have his guard up. But we can see from our vantage point, he wasn't all there. He was hurt. He got lit up.
Yeah. First big left hook, I'm sure we'll see it, is what started it off. And you know, the cannon just, he let loose.
Pretty impressive performance by Brandon Adams. Dub Huntley in his corner. Obviously a relationship with Freddie Roach. Through the connection with Eddie Futch, and Brandon Adams here at the Wild Card Boxing Club takes care of business in round number two. Let's look back and watch how Adams finished off Duverson.
Right there, we missed the left hook, but the left hook is what started it. And I can see it from here. He was light on his feet.
Sonny, get out of
hands
there,
up, but he's now all the way there.
Get out of there. Stop, that's
and
it.
You can hear Jackson, get out of there, Sonny, get out of there.
That was all set up by those hooks to the body. Great stuff from Brandon Adams.
Yep. You touch a guy downstairs to get him looking there, and then you bring it up top. Good job.
Brandon Adams with career win number 22. And he gets his 14th stoppage.
Hey Brandon, want to come back in, please?
And for Sonny Duverson now, three losses in a row. He's gone 0-4 October, November, and December.
The thing I've always said is it's not about the losses, it's how you lose. And, you know, when you lose giving the value and effort and you're on your feet and things like that, you can live to see another day and fight another day. But, you know, taking a third loss like that is going to be detrimental to his career.
For the official time of the stoppage, here's Lupe Contreras.
This bout concludes with an official time of 1:40 of round number two. Your winner, by way of knockout from the city of Watts, Brandon Cannon Adams.
He came out to the gap band. You dropped the bomb on me, and he certainly did to the body and then head of Sonny Duverson here tonight.
Well, it started with movement, and it started with going to the body. And then right here, this is not where Sonny wants to be. And Brandon was able to come right up top with the left hook. You can see he was light on his feet at that point. Covers, because he's hurt, covers to protect himself. But Jack, again, Jack's a responsible ref. He doesn't want to see you not getting hit, getting hurt, and not coming back. And you can see the cannon, he even pulled back a little bit. And that gives the impression, even if you're not hurting the guy, it gives the impression that it's harder than it looks.
He's a different fighter from joining Jermall Charlo's camp, his former opponent. You see the confidence in his punching power tonight.
Yep. And even with 400 plus days off, he showed out tonight.
Brandon Adams gets the victory in impressive fashion. He's with Curran.
Thanks, guys. I'm here with the winner, Brandon Adams. So, Brandon, it had been 523 days since your last fight. What does it mean to you to have that break and then come in there and do what you just did?
It means a lot to me. I'm just grateful for the opportunity of being here, fighting at the Wild Card. One of my trainers, Freddie Roach. I'm super excited to be able to get back out and fight again. It's been a minute, but like I said, man, if I counted how many days I missed out on being able to fight, I could hold a grudge. but I didn't. I was just extremely grateful and thankful for getting back out here fighting again on NBC. I appreciate the opportunity, man, and hopefully, you know what I'm saying, I held up my end of the bargain at keeping everybody, you know what I'm saying, excited for me to debut here.
Was it extra motivation? Obviously, you were supposed to fight Serhii Bohachuk. At the last minute, they brought in Sonny. He was a tough opponent. He had had success recently. Even in losses, he looked good. Was it extra motivation to beat him because it was a late-minute replacement?
You know what? My game plan was it stayed the same from the beginning. Seek and destroy. I want to come out here and win. It didn't matter who you guys put in front of me. It's very unfortunate, you know, that COVID is running rapid, you know, and hopefully we figure out a way of getting it, you know, all together. But for the most part, you know, the show didn't end. It continued, and hopefully I ended it well with this punctuation mark tonight.
So speaking of Serhii Bohachuk, he was watching your fight, and he tweeted, good, let's make the fight happen. What would be your response to Bohachuk?
I don't know. I don't tweet. You know, for the most part, you know, I'm not prepared to turn nothing down right now, you know what I'm saying? So if the opportunity presents itself, you're damn right, we're going to fight.
So that's what's next. Now let's look back at what just happened here. The end of that last round, take me through what you remember at the end of that last round, and here are the highlights. Talk us through what you see here.
Well, I know I'm the shorter guy, honestly, and every time when he wanted to throw big, I knew, you know, his arms were going to take some time because he had the 80-inch reach. I knew I was going to be able to execute on the fact that my arms are a little shorter. I'm shorter. I'm more compact. So I just wanted to take advantage of that. And me, you know, coming from 160, I've learned a thing or two about being, you know, the bigger guy. And I just wanted to take advantage of that and seize the moment. I felt like I did.
And you told us in fighter meetings your motivation growing up in Watts, you wanted to prove you existed. Do you feel like you proved you existed tonight?
I don't know. That's for the people to choose. I mean, to decide. You know, every day that go by, you know what I'm saying, we have the opportunity to prove so. And today will be one of my testimonies.
Brandon Adams, he's the winner tonight. Back to you guys.
Thank you, guys, and I appreciate it.
Brandon Adams, he had to deal with an opponent change. He referenced Freddie Roach, obviously working with Freddie here at the Wild Card Boxing Club in conjunction with Dub Huntley. And listen, he did what he was supposed to do, right? You got a guy in there as a late replacement, Sean. You go out there and you emphatically put your foot down and don't leave anything for chance.
Let me say this. Is the good part about it was Sonny's, yeah, Sonny's been active. It's not like we replaced Cannon's opponent with someone who hadn't been working and had been training. He was ready for the fight. It just Brandon Adams was the better man tonight.
I mean, Sonny Duverson brought legitimate danger in here. He'd been in camp with Jason Rosario, the former junior middleweight champion. They had wars in there. He was ready, but Adams made a statement.
Yeah. All right, let's go back up to Kern, who's with Sonny.
Here with Sonny Duverson. So, Sonny, you stepped in last minute to take on Brandon Adams. What do you think about what happened in the fight tonight?
I congratulate the man for everything he did. He just was the better man tonight. No excuses. I laid on the ropes a little too long. I didn't stick to my game plan. Started off slow, but it's on to the next. No worries.
In fighter meetings, we spoke about you have the length. You want to use your jab, but you tend to brawl. Is that something you think you might change going forward?
Yeah, definitely. That's just something that me and my team, we've been working on, but it's something hard to get out of me. But we're going to get back to the drawing board and fix everything.
And you took this fight on short notice, like we said. Your last few fights, they were on short notice. You've been fighting in the bubble. You've been active. What's next for you? Where do you go from here?
Back in the gym, man. First thing next week or as soon as I can. And next fight, I'm back on it. No, ain't nothing stopping it. It's all a little jump, bump in the road, but nothing too major.
I'm sure we'll see you back in there.
Oh, definitely, definitely.
Back to you guys.
Short notice, Sonny Duverson might have to rethink the strategy a little bit.
I mean, he told us leading in, Bob, he fought in prison 300 times and never lost in unsanctioned bouts. He's used to fighting inside. You got to use those gifts, though, that you're given to set up your power shots.
Yeah, I mean, when we talk about levels, that right there is a demonstration of where the champions go and where the other guys don't go. When you're smart enough to figure out what you got to do, you do that opposed to being who you are every time out.
All right, guys, here's a look at what we saw tonight. Ring City USA in tonight's card. Brandon Adams defeating Sonny Duberson. Brian Sabayo defeats Larry Gomez with a unanimous decision. Guys, what did you think of what Sabayo did in the ring?
I thought Sabayo looked very good. I thought that he's got all the intangibles it takes to become a world champion. It's just a matter of time.
Yeah, he can benefit from the rounds here. It was a tough out, and Larry Gomez in front of him, an aggressive guy who was landing. But Sabayo seems to have the full package. He's getting more seasoned each step up the ladder.
And then Gore Yuritsian. With the win over Montez, he stops him in round number 6. Could have probably stopped the fight a little bit earlier than that, but it looks like Freddie Roach has a pretty good prospect there, Sean.
Absolutely. No doubt that Gore has, again, has a lot of the same intangibles that Sabayo has in terms of his boxing ability, punch selection, power's there as well. I like Gore tonight.
Well, in 2 weeks, we are back in action with Ring City USA. Here at the Wild Card Boxing Club is Charles Conwell, 13-0 with 10 KOs, squaring off against Madiyar Ashkiyev, 14-0 with 7 knockouts. That's coming up on December the 17th.
Charles Conwell, one of the brightest prospects in all of boxing, regardless of weight. But you know how we match him tough in this series? 14-0, 7 KOs his opponent. Can't wait to see Conwell. Hey. Somebody stand up to him. Let's see what happens.
Conwell's from Cleveland, baby. Woo! I ain't worried.
There you go. Well, we'll get to see Cleveland's own as Sean continues to root on his Cleveland Browns this weekend as well. Well, it was an impressive performance here this evening by Brian Sabayo. He comes up with the victory. Gore Yuritsian a winner, and Brandon Adams finishes the show. That'll do it for tonight. Don't forget to join us on December the 17th at 9 p.m. Eastern, Ring City. So for Sean Porter, Brian Campbell, and Kern Bhatia, I'm Bob Papa saying good night from Los Angeles.
Multi-million dollar, I'm a fool with the hits. Hop off in the lemon, drop the roof. Popping, but you really not gon' shoot. 90 pointers, time my diamond look like hoops. Hopping, mopping, take her in the seat, it's up my suits. Felicia, y'all gon' check my price with Valentino boots. It's the boom and out of way, a lot of them, a lot of race. Never hesitate to give the yellow tape. And worry about the bag, cause the cash accumulate. Soon as we came in the game, all these, they imitated. Put my mind on it, then I put my grind on it. Put the iron on them and my opponent. My code 500, I don't put no miles on it. I was running wild, homie, with 500 thal on me. Going to the jeweler, bust the AP, yeah. Sliding on the water like a jet ski, yeah. I'm trying to put you on your bestie, yeah. Chopper with this girl, so do not test me, yeah. Big blood drip, go woo on it. 5790, spit the coupe on my wrist. Multi-million dollar, I'm a fool with the hits. Hop up in the lemon, drop the woo for the cops. I'm rich, but I've been broke. Last night I had a dream about a kick dope. I used to cross state lines just to get dope. Wanna press my line, gotta fish for it. I'm all alone in the crowd, don't touch me. Smoking, I'm frustrated. Lie to my girl when she bring it up much later. Nah, I just crush a lot. Boss off, re-rock till I whip the watch. Must've hit me from the yacht, drunk laughing at chop. They said it's grind time, a gang of won't your spot. Look, a gang of these new won't be popped. That's why a gang of these little don't get shot. It's off to grow up. And what you sew up, sit your down, get your dough up. I don't never judge with my nose up, I'ma blow up. Ooh, I'm out money on that note. I'm 100 to the point you get taxed for it. If I ever need your hand, I ask for it. Until then, I'ma be on my like, ooh, I'ma get rich on you. And I'ma be richer.